friends, Ram Yadav is a very different person, and I've been interacting with him from quite a number of months. A very deep person, fantastic knowledge about funds management, financials, economy, global scenario, international policies, government policies, planning, and the works. He's absolutely associated with real estate in a very big way. He has a very impactful thought process of what can benefit not only the sector, but also the customers and the consumers. But we are not going to be discussing with him in terms of real estate. We are going to discuss Ram Yadav as a person, as a personality. So it's a journey where you started from a contracting, one of the oldest and largest contracting organization, Shapoorji Pallonji. Then you got exposure to being a developer, a strong pillar of a development organization. And today you're in the capital market. You started the concept of active credit, or credit which gets monitored when it gets disbursed from a financial institution. How has this journey helped you to define what you do currently?
Well, working with close to three organizations by now, and I think only right thing in the introduction was that I follow economics more because I'm a learner, not because I'm an expert. India's ecosystem of governance is quite broken, and the reason of a broken governance structure in the companies is because we are equity starved. We do not invest a lot in creating a governance structure which can then take the growth or sustain the growth and then scale. And this is one of the biggest learnings to start with. The second is that I don't want to complicate that how I actually fared through this journey. It was just pure chance. There was no plan to start from contracting because I did not even know fully well that Shapoorji Pallonji is all about contracting. I joined a company because I thought it was very big. I was put in the contracting division where I learned the skill. And after that, it was only a chance that I joined a developer. Again, it was only a chance that I joined a bank. But because I had, you know, the experience right from contracting.
How did you plan so many chances?
It just happened. It just happened.
It just happened, or was there a strategy to it?
No, it just happened, and after that I just articulated it that as if it was all planned.
So you have made some very defining moments for the sector, especially in the real estate. And what I feel today as Ram Yadav as a person is you have a very strong understanding of the economy, of the financials, and how capital moves and how deployment needs to happen, gets controlled and comes back to the organization. How did you define that journey? There are so many capital institutions in the country who never did this, but you are one of the first people who did that very effectively and successfully. How did you plan that?
See, it was very simple because real estate actually only started, it's not even an industry today. I mean, real estate
is considered a sector.
It is just considered as a sector as part of the infrastructure and construction. One of the key issues with this is that being a new industry, and as you rightly said, sector, you do not have practices and you do not have enough amount of investment in organizational structure. If you look at today a developer, there are at least four or five facets of development. You need to have expertise around land acquisition, around maturing of the land, getting permissions, design, engineering. Then the third part is execution, and the fourth is selling. Real estate, unfortunately, does not even consider customer as the key centric to its business. If you talk to at least five people in the room in real estate, they would either say that their expertise lies in licensing or land acquisition, or possibly even in execution, but nobody, and I bet, nobody will say that their expertise lies around servicing a customer.
Fantastic. That's a very good find. And you also created the position of a customer experience officer with the same intention to make sure that customer experiences are the true capital of a real estate sector as an industry, if it is a, whenever it becomes an industry or a sector. What realization, how do you get this kind of realizations which are game changers in the industry? Like active credit is a game changer, customer experience officer is a game changer. What creates these game changing ideas in your mind?
So by being very simple, when I was a developer on the other side, bankers gave the money on the basis of, you know, fine presentations that I made, and after that they only chased me to get their money back. And it was very simple, you know, having a CXO in place, we only changed the context. We said that if in a real estate development, if customer buys the product and you are able to service him by delivering to the design and to the quality promised, your money will come back. So in a very simplistic way, we said that if we are able to go and manage, monitor, and administrate a project from an end buyer's perspective, if he is safe, our money certainly is safe. It's a very simple philosophy. So that's how the whole concept of active credit and the customer experience. So I do not consider developer as a customer. I consider developer as one party in the entire ecosystem who's responsible to deliver a dream home eventually to an end buyer. I consider end buyer as the real customer.
So you ensure that the deployment of the money that is happening to the developer who's your customer, money customer, but ultimately it has to come through the customer's customer.
Absolutely.
So you make sure that the deployment is happening to the benefit of the end user customer.
Absolutely.
And it is not deviated, because many a times a lot of deviation in the funds happen,
right.
Siphoning of the funds happen.
Right.
So the active credit is a policy where you monitor the deployment of funds.
Absolutely.
And you have been successfully doing that.
Right. So I consider that a team of 200 bright professionals is actually, you know, taking care of a customer's financial money in by being a fiduciary responsible team. I mean, they are in their own fiduciary responsibility being treasurers to the customers and not to the developer.
So when you deploy money, what is the criteria that you look when you're deploying the money on a particular developer? What is the criteria that you look?
Largely, it's driven where the money is going. I mean, most of our hypothesis is drawn around when we pay the money, where does it go?
You all are national players. Do you define the territory where the fund should flow more, where it is more safer, where it is more not becoming an NPA and funds coming in back faster, the market growing faster, effective customers being in the pipeline all the time? Do you look at the demographics of the country before you deploy money?
We do. We do. So if you look at the established real estate, close to about 80% of real estate volume only happens in the 7 top cities in India. Rest is absolutely unorganized.
Which are the 7 top cities? Mumbai,
so it starts
Delhi.
From Mumbai, Delhi, Kolkata, Bangalore, then you have Pune. So
and Chennai.
Yeah, and Chennai.
And Chennai.
And
what do you think will happen to the rest of the countries if all financial institutions focus only on 7 cities?
So I think if I have to answer this in terms of economics, we are currently just touching about $3 trillion. And the decentralization of wealth in India has just started happening. So if you look at Ahmedabad actually is now the real 8th market. If you look at Indore, if you look at even the cities like Mangalore, Coimbatore, these are now the emerging cities. One of the problem India faced for a long time was that employment was all clustered around these 5-6 cities only. Now that has started spreading. And that is a good news, because now the real growth of real estate industry will start happening.
As entrepreneurs, we always have challenges on the recruitment process, team people, people quality, people qualifications and all of that. What we have realized is you at Edelweiss, you have got a 200 people team, you have got people from aerospace, you have got people from different backgrounds, not directly connected to real estate as a sector or finance as a sector. So what's the logic behind that?
So the logic is
you have got data analysts, you have got aerospace experts, you have chartered accountants, a lot of people who are not connected directly to the real estate sector.
So the logic is diversity. I mean, creating a diverse team which can bring a completely different aspect in the business. I mean, if you look at when we started hunting for a data science guy for our team, a lot of people said that in banking, why would you need a data scientist? But the whole idea was that if you are going to scale and grow, and that is where the exponentiality come, a lot of entrepreneurs actually do not give credit to the economy that they are operating in. I think we are too busy in the laundry list of what will happen in this quarter and what will happen in the next quarter. The real story of India is happening in the effect of compounding of growth. I mean, believe it or not, just in about 7 years from now, we'll be about $5 trillion economy. And currently, we are just at about $70 billion of credit with the similar amount of people that are in China. In China, the total credit is $700 billion, 100 times. I mean, that's the kind of scale is there, but entrepreneurs are too busy on the quarter and the, you know, maybe a year. But if you are building a business, and when you ask that question, why would you need a data scientist? Aerospace is only by an accident, because somebody in IIT Bombay said that, you know, he wants to work for real estate. And then we took him. I'm still figuring out with him why he wanted to then study aerospace. But, you know.
Well, when an organic chemistry person can do branding.
I mean, I have now got an example.
As a finance company, there are two aspects to what you face every day: procurement of funds and deployment of funds. How do you balance to make sure that it is optimum at most of the times?
Well, it's a difficult question in one sense, and in another, it is not very difficult, I'll tell you, because again, money is all about demand and supply. We can generally know in today's situation that yes, demand is very high, but you also know supply would be low. You have elections, you have liquidity crisis, government itself is a bigger borrower. So you plan and, you know, space yourself out in a manner that you are at least thinking 6 to 9 months ahead of the time.
So you make sure that you plan for the next 6 to 9 months ahead of time.
Absolutely.
How do you compete with the other fund organizations in the country who are NBFCs like your organization? And how do you beat them in the marketplace? Or how do you play with them in the marketplace?
So we generally learn a lot from competition. I mean, unlike any other industry, disruption in financial services is happening only in terms of opening the newer demand. The existing lateral demand still exists. So competition plays a very big role in teaching you what best to do and how. So in places we are teaching the competition, in other places we are learning it from them.
So I'm sure everybody does that. And what is the difference that you do as far as that process is concerned? Are there any recipes of you doing it better than the others are doing it?
As I said, rather than, you know, monitoring every day that where my money has gone, you start monitoring where the money is going to come from that will retire your debt. And that's where we change the context, that rather than following the developer, we started following the buyer and starting to, you know, beat the developer, saying now deliver to the buyer so that the money comes to you.
You are one of the first financial institutions who have taken very seriously the role of distribution and ensuring that X component of the stock is always under distribution and your control, so that the money that you have deployed is at least protected to the extent of the distribution that you're going for the developer. Right. This idea was to make sure and balance out that your deployment is safe. What was the idea behind that?
The basic idea was around two things. One, that when we are lending in an industry which is still evolving, you are certainly taking a larger risk. And when you are taking a larger risk, you will not only make the competitive financial return, but you will also want to at least make 200, 300, 400 basis point more, because you are taking a risk in an industry. Now, rather than taking a blind risk, we said that we will not only earn in the distribution an extra profit, but that will also become a tool for us to save our franchise value, that we are then following the developer like a customer and not like a lender.
You strongly believe, I've been noticing y'all as Edelweiss as an organization and your team specifically, you all strongly believe in always enriching the knowledge of your teammates very aggressively. I think you all are one of the most aggressive knowledge acquiring organization in the country. And you being the leader, you're driving it from the front. How has that helped you in the last 5 years of this particular process?
Yeah, so our belief is, again, driven out of the data. The shelf life of knowledge prior to the IT revolution was about 20 years. About 8 years back, it reduced to some 7 years. And our belief is that apart from just learning the language and the normal mathematics, at some point of time, knowledge will be disrupted itself. So you have to keep on enriching and, you know, learning new things. And that's the only way you will be able to save yourself from the biggest competition, that is disruption, happening on the sites that you are not even looking at. So one of the strategies at Edelweiss to consistently invest in training is not on soft training side, but also on the business side, is keeping in mind that the shelf life of knowledge is deteriorating fast. You have to keep on putting more and more.
Fantastic. Ram, I know of an entrepreneur who has around a team size of 65 people. And all these 65 people are in the knowledge domain. And I asked him, what is your role in that business model? And he replied, which surprised me, that the only job in my business that I do is I recruit every team mate personally. My biggest role in my organization is I'm the recruiter. So I make sure that the asset that has come on board is worth the value, will have a longevity with us, and will perform the output that I desire. You have a team of 200 people. What is the role that you play when you run this process in your organization?
So I made my life a little simpler. So I only recruit the leaders. And then every year, at least, I spend my personal time recruiting the freshers. We call them the lateral recruits from IIMs, from IITs. And it, in a very simple way, what we have done is we let the leaders build their own teams so that the character of the organization, the culture of organization increases on one hand. On other hand, we have created a competition for the middle team by bringing the new people who actually always will keep on challenging the status quo and the culture of the organization.
How do you monitor the productivity of your people?
Simply by encouraging them. How I think they monitor my productivity more than I monitor theirs.
And how do you keep them motivated?
So as Kiran mentioned in the earlier conversation, that the key recipe of humans to be motivated to do something, to cross the lines, is the sense of pride. And at Edelweiss, as I am proud to be an entrepreneur, part of Edelweiss, we have this DNA right to the last guy, that if he has an idea, he'll get the respect of not only presenting, but getting even funded. And there is absolute democracy there, and anybody can walk with an idea. That itself creates the kind of energy that you have 200 entrepreneurs and not necessarily people compartmentalized in departments who just can't raise their head beyond what they are doing every day.
So you all actually believe ideas create?
And values protect.
And values protect. You actually believe that?
Absolutely.
So what is the learning curve of Ram Yadav?
So one of the biggest things that I have learned, and this is very important from, you know, growing exponentially, because in India, if we really want to solve problem of more than 125 crore people, we simply cannot be linear. We'll have to think exponential, whether it is in terms of technology, whether it is in terms of manufacturing, infrastructure, everything. My learning curve has been that in India, entrepreneurs actually are very reserved when taking risks. They have to take risks, they have to bet big and just get out of their comfort zone of the quarter and year. They have to believe in the India story for long. You cannot just bet against it.
Whenever I communicate with you, apparently I always come across a word called exponential. How is it so connected with you? And it is also your background. You have got exponential growth and you have started thinking only in billions. So what is the word psychologically, how is it connected with you?
So you are a shining example of word exponential, by the way. What one can think and achieve in 24 hours, you would generally do it in 8 hours. This is exponentiality. I mean, a lot of your friends, my friends, the common ones always say, is it Rajesh or is it Ghost, right? You are not there, but you know, almost everywhere. This is exponentiality, and the simple definition of exponentiality is how can you do more in given resources with the same amount of energy by utilizing everything which is there in the ecosystem freely available to you. That is what is exponentiality.
Fantastic. I also know that you're a staunch follower of Swami Vivekananda. What is the greatest learning that you got from him?
I started reading after reading about him.
And what is that one thing that you will share which inspired you, what he has written? Like, for example, there was a book written by our friend who read that book and changed his life. No, Kiran Khalap has read a book which changed his life, J. Krishnamurti. And it changed his life exponentially. And he started doing what he started doing after he read that book. Similarly, what is that one learning that you took from Swami Vivekananda which impacted you?
I think one key learning from Swami Vivekananda, not just for me, but for a lot of followers of him, is that age is not a barrier to what you can be and what you can achieve in life. And it's again, you know, the concept of him that life is not permanent and you have to live, but when you live, you have to also leave a mark to the society that you are living in, is what inspires me the most.
Fantastic. I think your best friends are books, and you read a book a week and you then compile them in 20 minutes in a single page, the synopsis of that particular book. I'm sure this keeps you excited. How do you make sure the type of books that you read which will keep your tempo high?
Well, I buy a book without thinking that what will be therein. I read it. If I like it, I read it in 2 days. If I don't like it, I read it in 2 hours.
And when do you decide that?
When I start reading.
When you start reading, you Absolutely. Get the flavor of it.
Absolutely.
So Ram Yadav is today associated with only real estate and the finance sector. When will this knowledge be deployed to multiple sectors, across sectors?
So one of the events that I'm attending has already started doing it. I'm sure there'll be more like this.
Excellent. Friends, the house is open for questions from you, and we'll take some more questions during your questions. Please. 5 questions to be asked.
The most interesting thing you talked about is creating customer experience. There's a lovely quote which says that people will forget what you said, people will forget what you did, but they will always remember how you made them feel. So what are the key ingredients in you creating the customer service experience?
It's again simple. While the CXO is here, I'm just taking this question on her behalf. Shweta, if you may know. I think the simplest way to think about customer centricity or experience is how you would want to be behaved and how would you like to be experiencing when you are buying something. So try and do that to yourself. And whatever is the height of that experience, go and implement it for your customers.
Yes. Yeah, Vinay.
Yeah. Go on. Real estate is an industry of finance, or is it an industry of intelligence and skills?
I think every industry is a matter of intelligence and skill. It's an absolutely wrong notion to say that real estate is all about capital.
Yes, Nago.
Ram, that was very nice, and you're as composed as ever. You're in the area of selling money. That's like high risk. And you're like living with risk all the time, because it's easy to put it out, tough to get it back. So you have a CXO in place, you have experience, you're talking about all of this. What are those one or two key things that you ensure as an organization to make sure that whatever you have given out comes back the way you had planned?
I think it's a very detailed question, but I'll try and answer as much short as possible. So we look at three things when we are lending money. We look at first the counterparty. Who are we lending? The second is the collateral. If we are lending for a project, what is the value of that collateral? What is the liquidity in that collateral? What will be the velocity assumption and the pricing that you'll be able to drive? That's the collateral. And the third most important is the cash flow. While every entrepreneur would project a cash flow, but we do the stress test by understanding whether he'll be able to do that or not. So when you put all three things together, the counterparty, we call it 3C, counterparty, collateral, and the cash flow, it becomes easier for you to lend. But that's half job done. Then you have to really live with it.
Yes, Sushant.
Mr. Ram, my question to you is, you are master of exponential growth. So as entrepreneurs, I'm sure all of us are looking forward for having that kind of an exponential growth. So what's your mantra of success when it comes to exponential growth?
So I'm not a master of exponential growth. I'm a practitioner of exponential growth.
And he has mastered that practice.
So there are a couple of very simple things in when you think about and design an organization for exponential growth. If you take example of any company which you call as really exponential, whether you call Google or you call Uber, you will see that very less number of people have achieved the highest valuation because they have chosen not to do everything by themselves. If you look at their capital structure, it is outsourced. So they borrow the capital, which is a third party capital, and they only become a treasurer to that. If you look at their staff, it is again outsourced. Their staff is completely on demand. There are lakhs and lakhs of people working for Amazon, not even knowing that they are not their employees or their employees. So that is the real staff on demand. I mean, if you look at in real estate, it's very simple to create a platform for distribution when you go to thousands of brokers and just call them partners and only secure their payouts. They become your employees without being on your roll. So you're not taking the liability, but you are enjoying the return on that asset. This is what is exponential organization. I would say, looking at the ecosystem, at places you'll partner by taking, at places you'll partner by giving. Both the ways. It's a collaborative.
Yeah. Last question. Yeah.
My question is directed to Rajesh. He was very excited about today's inspiring conversation because they were all his favorite people that he was doing it with. So I want to understand your experience, Rajesh. How was your inspiring conversations today?
Right. Well, fantastic experience, all our stalwarts, whether it is Roshan who's playing on the global sector with Trip Villas, with technology in place, Kiran, of course, with his fantastic humor, and he himself as a personal brand, and Ram, again a phenomenal person, great human being, and the knowledge that he has on capital, on customer experience, market demographics, growth story, the macroeconomics of India. It's all absolutely magical. So I've enjoyed all three absolutely thoroughly. We need to ask how they enjoyed the experience. That was a question. Of how you're enjoying the experience.
I think the last two conversations for sure were absolutely thought-provoking, and especially on Kiran's take on James Bond. I have never heard evolution of a brand with such case or example.
Even the latest James Bond might not know that. So Ram, that's fantastic. We are having all brilliant entrepreneurs here, and you have been a professional entrepreneur all your life. The vision that you have, the details that you have about India as a country, what are the growth sectors, how it will benefit young entrepreneurs, and what is the advice that you would like to give to upcoming entrepreneurs? Capital being the worst challenge for every entrepreneur. For him, the nightmare is capital. From where capital will come, how it will come, at what price it will come, when it will come. What is your advice to the house?
So, we are, as I said in the start itself, we are an equity-starved country. We need a lot of equity. And till about 80s, the equity was available, more social equity, with a lot of groups that you see, Tata, Mahindra, Birlas. Now, the democratization of credit has already happened. There is so much of capital now following India. Almost every large fund that you talk to is ready to start with at least $10 billion on individual platform deals. So there is no dearth of capital for India, because when you even say Asia, Asia is actually India now, because you're not then talking Philippines, you're not talking Vietnam, you're not talking China, Japan is already done. So India has that edge. You have to build the strategic integrity of your business plan and really work towards it. Think big, take risks. Capital will certainly follow you. I think the age of you following the capital has already gone.
Fantastic, fantastic, fantastic. That was excellent, Ram. Thank you so much. We thoroughly enjoyed what you shared. I would like to request Nagu and Geeta to please come up and do the honors. So this is the couple which started from here, the first inspiring conversations, and they are here today at the same venue. And coincidentally, Ram, for your information, the entire city of Bombay was not available for today's evening. And the only venue which was available today was, again, the same place from where we began. And the couple with whom we began inspiring conversations, which was a surprise to them then, they had come here for a tourist outlay to the city of Mumbai, just becoming tourists for shopping. And we just tricked them into it. Samir was witness to that. We told them that we have to attend a function in this particular hotel. We called them here. All of my 100 friends were sitting in the hall, and suddenly we took them and put them on the stage, and we started the interview. So that's how Inspiring Conversations began 5 years back. And we are so proud that today, after so many years, we come back to the same venue. We did some very interesting sessions, and we are here today at the last session of with Mr. Ram Yadav. Thank you. Nagu. Fortunately, Ram is a teetotaler. I don't know what Kiran is going to do with the cup. So this is a coffee mug.